as the flies of romance start to fade in the shade of the shadows of the mess we made. I try to laugh, but I'm all choked up, cause there ain't nothing funny about breaking up. I see you cry, but it don't hurt no more, cause I don't see what we're fighting for. And I'm sad, cause I know I've been bad, a world full of trouble, but I just end up getting mad. But I ain't lost belief, I just can't find the peace. Maybe you wanna see who cease to be. You make it so plain, it ain't no mystery. You just wanna hang with your own group of friends, cause you just can't hide from the fact that this is the end. So hear what I say, hear what I say. Point your finger and say, I gotta change. Now we stand on a bridge over troubled water. You wanna jump, but I know the way's shorter. I've been through it before, you see, so I recognize that you're testing me. But now school's over, we ain't rolling in the cover. You can pull the wool over your own as if you wanna. There's nothing left but a pause, a loose end. I'm waiting for a sign that you ain't ever gonna send. I'm sick and tired of being fired up just to defend. Well, this is the end. So hear what I say, hear what I say.
Hello, welcome to the HomeBhoys Late Phone-In Show here on a Monday night. It's now 20 to 8. Tonight is the season finale, where we're going to look back over everything that's happened this year. When I say look back over everything that's happened this year, I mean the bits and pieces we can pull together through drunken memories and probably just complete another misinformation. That's why we have Paul Larkin here, because he's the man who tries to keep us right on that. Paul, you there?
I'm here.
I just finished listening to your Beyond the Wave show there just before we hooked up there on Skype. It was brilliant.
Oh, thanks very much.
That girl at the end is fantastic singing that song.
Yeah, that was a real treat to when I first heard that, to be honest. You know, it was, you've got a lot to live up to, Joe.
I know, because it was coming up and I was like, do I really need to listen to this? This is going to put me in a bad mood. No, that was great. It was great for us. And we also have Jason Higgins.
Hey there, mate.
We're not joined by Harper tonight. He's indisposed. Is that what they say? Not capable. He's fragile. It's hungover, basically, we're trying to say. So we're just going to bat it on. Now, if you want to call us, which I imagine some of you may, call us on Skype. If you haven't got Skype, just Google it, because there's nothing else I can do, but I'll give you like an instruction manual here. But just Google Skype. It's easy, right? You can get it on your phone. Also, if you want to call us on the more terrestrial landline, it's a Glasgow number, 0141 356 7327. That's 0141 356 7327. I'm going to paste that into the chat room here, and I'm going to put it up on Twitter as well. Why do you see multitasking, people? This is what we're all about here at the Homeboys. Without further ado, if you want to call up, just usual stuff, we'll add you into the call, and then if we remember you're there, which sometimes we forget, we'll chat to you. You can bring up whatever you want. Call us some of like your best memories or your, you know, players you thought were going to live up to more. There's loads of things we can talk about, loads of aspects we can go through. Right? But we can go all the way back to the start of the season, should we? Just straight off. Or will we actually talk about the last game of the season?
Let's get a 3-1 Dundee United. Yeah. Quite enjoyed it.
You're both at it, yeah?
Yeah.
Smashing crowd. But then again, they still have that big thing across the seats, don't they? More than a club.
The upper Rangers end. Obviously, it was a good crowd for the tickets that they sold, but there was obviously that bit there, so it's nowhere near capacity, which is... at the end of the day, it was a Sunday 12:15 kickoff or whatever, which isn't ideal for a lot of people. But you're getting the league championship, you've won the league, you would think you could maybe sell it out. But probably that's just the state football's in general. 50,000, you can't really complain. 50,000 crowd, you know.
The atmosphere looked great as well.
Yeah, it was really good.
You know, and like I was watching the hotel in Ibiza. And like they had the Formula One on, so I couldn't really hear what was going on, and I didn't get to watch the celebrations afterwards until I actually got home. But some of the stuff was great, like Samaras taking wee Jay out of the crowd and Neil
giving
him his medal and stuff, you know, and the whole You Never Walk Alone and the applause for Oscar and all, it was real. Yeah, say inside the stadium it was fairly emotional and really made a big difference.
I was delighted at Samaras' kind of send off that he got. Yeah, the crowd was right behind him, and he kind of changed the game, see, when he came on. Because I thought Dundee United were potentially the better side, you know. It was a typical end of season encounter when nothing much at stake, but Dundee United, they were passing the ball about well, but Samaras just gave us the wee spark that we needed. And funnily enough, I was saying to one of my mates walking out the ground, I was kind of thinking Griffiths was playing better than Stokes. And I was saying, what if you took Stokes off? What if you took Griffiths off? Or I would have kept him on and put Stokes off. But just not long after Sammy comes on, Stokes gets the first goal. And to be fair, Samaras injected a bit of impetus into the game, and I kind of changed the game, and it's a good victory in the end up. And the atmosphere was really, really good. I thought the crowd was really good. And then at the end, I don't know about you, Paul, but see this manufactured celebration? That's my head in. What about yourself?
No, I mean, because the fans were really good, and it's kind of like there's no real need for the kind of pomp and ceremony that goes with it, and the fireworks and fucking loud explosion. I mean, we're going mental about bangers at the start of the season, and then they're firing them off themselves, you know, which half the crowd almost fainted it. So I agree, it's like the fans create the atmosphere, and you know, it was good. It's always at the end of the day, that's what it's all about. Eh? It's like you start every season, you want to win that league, and you know, we've done that, and you know, credit to the players for keeping it going. 99 points and over 100 league goals is some an achievement, like, you know what I mean? And we've probably gone in, I think we're going into a kind of close season where, for the first time I can remember, everybody's not saying, right, we need to sign this, we need to sign that, we need to do this. You know, the teams kind of have been evolving throughout the season. And of course, we do need to make one or two signings, but I think people are quite excited about the young talent we've got coming through, and just the way, the kind of expansive way we're playing in the now, you know?
Yeah. No, I thoroughly enjoyed it. And I don't know about yourself, did you get caught in that rain after the game?
Well, actually, no, I never, because I went to the Kerrydale bar for the first time, pretty much for the first time, and but funnily enough, a lot of people were talking about that last week, but the Kerrydale bar, I don't think it'll be back, to be honest. Like, it's no, apart from the fact it costs an absolute fortune, as a connoisseur of drink like myself, I'm not really into just drinking tennis lager and sitting in a big bar near a place, but that's another story. But no, I believe it was terrible. Like,
well, me and my mate walked into the town, and we got to sort of just buy Pizza Hut sort of thing, heading through like Barrafield, and oh my god, the heavens just opened, and just for like 10 minutes I'd have been dry, I'd jump in the Clyde.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I was soaked through, but like, it was a good day, enjoyed it, and it's always good to pick up another league championship. I've many barren years in my Celtic support life, and I'll never take these for granted, so I'm not one of these guys that's complaining. I'm pretty happy with proceedings. I know there's things that we can all moan about, but at the end of the day, Celtic winning championships, happy days for me.
Right, let's try and keep us upbeat tonight, because I don't want to get too downcast. I mean, like this time last season, you're probably thinking to yourself, oh yeah, treble next year, no problem, but it wasn't to be, but let's not focus on that. So let's jump all the way back to maybe this time last year, right? And then what were the friendlies that happened? And what fuck the friendlies? First game we played was what, Cliftonville Champions League?
Aye, competitive, aye.
So what that's one of my highlights of the season there, because that was a brilliant day up in Belfast. Like just the sun was out, everybody was all just kind of like one big crowd, if you know what I mean. And it was fantastic. Bangers going off, it was crazy.
And I noticed we could play them again, Joe.
I've seen that, eh?
This year, so I mean, who knows? You know,
because I mean, last year, Rick, I wasn't even drinking because me, Harper, and Richie drove up in the car, and they came straight back down. But I mean, even if you weren't drinking, it was just a great day. The crack was meaty. I mean, the majority of Belfast was there, and they were all completely drunk. But I mean, great result and great game, and it was just great stuff. You know, McAvaney was there. You got a big, Frankie, give us a wave. From the temporary section and stuff, which is brilliant.
Did he not play for Cliftonville as well?
He played one game for Cliftonville. Because
yeah.
I remember I told you this in the Cross Keys one day, Jason, that I was over with you, and you were like, what? Really? And somebody Googled that he played one game for Cliftonville and got them to the, I think, semi-final of the Cup. But
I never knew that myself.
I think he got paid a significant amount of money. And if I can recall, like all you could hear from the stands that day was, give the ball to Frank! Give it to Frank! but it's like still considered a Cliftonville legend, even if it was one only one game. Like, but it was a great day. I mean, so in terms of like moving through the season, then we got the early highlights. I want to share Carrigandy, I suppose.
No, the first game anyway.
Not the first game. First game was abysmal.
I'm just thinking. See the first one. What I was actually, sort of a wee bit happy about that. Wasn't like our media Bratislava that we says, right, we need to get this back here. We kind of took our medicine and says, right, we can get them back to Celtic Park, we can keep it at like a reasonable defeat, but it's still no beyond the realms of possibility we'll qualify. Whereas with the Shakhtar Karagatti and with our media Bratislava, we kind of, once we went two goals down, we'd done everything through the kitchen sink to try and get back into the game. Whereas if we just left it at 2-0, you know, if we'd sort of just took our medicine and get them back to Celtic Park, I think that's with the Karagandy game. Mm-hmm. I was, because there was a one stage of the game that looks as if we were all over the place and they could have scored a few more.
Aye, because I mean, it just shows you. I mean, I was talking about this yesterday, but things that happen in July, no matter if it's competitive or not, they never really mean much, you know, during a season. And you cast your mind back at that after that game, everybody's saying, Christ, what have we signed here with this boy Van Dijk? He's hopeless. And, you know, because he had made one mistake, blah, 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 and all the rest of it. But, you know, coming out of that game, I think everybody on this show that people phoned in, Twitter and that, were saying, Carrigandy are not a good side. You know, you could kind of see that right away. You had that one little boy, fucking that little prick, that was just like a nasty wee get, always trying to get throw-ins and things like that. And, you know, it was like, get them back to Celtic Park. And I think the game at Celtic Park, we scored the goals at the right time, you know, before and after half-time, and then, of course, in the last minute. And, you know, obviously, great play for Stokesy that set up for us, but I think everybody will always remember the manager running 40 yards to jump on the players when we scored, like, you know.
Yeah, no, that was a big highlight for me this season.
And especially when, I mean, in the context of it, you know, we certainly could effectively sold the family jewels around that time. You know, with Hooper and Wanyama and Kelvin Wilson had all gone, you know.
Yeah. I know, and we didn't know what we were letting ourselves, as you said. Big Virgil didn't exactly set the head on fire straight away, but what a player he's became to be throughout the season.
Aye.
he's up there with some of the best defenders I've ever seen at Celtic Park. And while we're on the subject of defenders, we'll go everybody wishes Danny McGrain speedy recovery for his minor sort of heart attack that he had. So one of my favourite all time Celtic players, and just wish Danny all the best.
I was listening to Off the Ball yesterday, and there was Tony Roper told a great story about him where he said that he'd had got an answering machine in the house, and the button's flashing, and he puts the thing on, and he just hears this voice, McGrain 2. And that was it. And he's like, looks at his wife, he says, what the hell was that? He says, play that again. He says, same again, McGrain 2. He says, that's Danny McGrain. So he phones him up. And he says, Danny, what's the story with that message you left on my answer machine? He says, I just done what the machine told me. Need your name and number. You know what I mean? But anybody that's ever encountered Danny McGrain just knows him, man. He's a total wind-up merchant. And, you know, he plays on the fact that you're standing there like a trembling wreck in the midst of a legend. And it's funny, one of the things that I read this week was, I think it was for Charlie Nicholas, who says Danny McGrain is the best player that ever played for Celtic. And he never really gets spoken about in that. And yet everybody, without question, no matter if they support Celtic or no, will always tell you he was genuinely world class.
Yeah, absolutely. He's one of my all-time favourites. And everybody, if you pick your all-time Celtic 11, he would be in it. He would be in everybody.
Oh, aye. I mean, to have such a career, I mean, he signed in 1967, played his last game in 1987, fractured his skull at Brockville, got diagnosed with diabetes in 1974, and yet he's just, he just had that level of consistency in players that you very rarely see anywhere now, where you were guaranteed a performance every single week.
And obviously, the goal that springs to everybody's mind was that Rat Johnston at Love Street in 85. And just the move started with Danny in the right back position.
Aye.
The 1-2, and he just made his way up the park, and it was an absolute treat to watch, and what a goal. It's one of my favourite all time Celtic goals, even though that F&B scored it.
I always remember because it was my first Celtic Rangers game and all, but his shot in the cup final in 1980 that McCluskey put in.
Aye.
And everybody around us, I can still remember this day, thinking everybody thought it was Danny McGrain that had actually scored that day. And of course, Danny was near renowned for scoring goals.
Aye.
But the word legend's overused, but certainly not for Danny McGrain.
No, and see celebration as well. No, the wee ran and the wee skip sort of thing, the wee jumped after a goal. And he didn't know what to do, did he? Oh, it was brilliant. Aye, happy days, man. So I wish him all the best, and I'm sure he's lived his life the right way, by keeping fit and stuff like that, and hopefully that will stand him in good stead.
Mm-hmm.
Aye.
So I'm trying to eat my dinner here as well, peacefully, and at the same time you two are talking.
Oh, Christ almighty.
I'm trying to keep it as quiet as possible, but I'm not using a knife and fork, I'm actually using my hands. Just to try and keep it. So if anybody's hearing any caveman sounds coming, it's me trying to eat this chicken peacefully. Anyway, I think I'm done now. So, anyway, Danny McGrain, brilliant. So, moving on, Carrigandy. My memory's shite, for a start. But I'm trying to remember, who was the first team he played in the season?
Ross County.
Oh, that's right, when Berigder, well, looked like a world beater for about 15 minutes.
Yeah, I've got to have an opposite point of view. This thing about Berigder in this game, honest to God, you think he was Maradona in 1986, the level of performance that people went.
He missed five sitters.
And then he got carted off, and he's never done anything since,
he did look impressive.
But no, it was a tough game. If you remember, Stokes, he scored with about 3-4 minutes to go, the winner that day. So it was quite a tough game. But I actually remember it mere for Sevco getting knocked out by Forfar in the League Cup that day. That kind of buzzed around. But no, it was, I think it was a Saturday. It was a late kickoff on a Saturday, if I think.
Might have been 5 o'clock.
I don't think the Premiership had quite started then.
Because I can mind there was millions of seagulls milling about, because obviously they've got their time clock, they can come down and whip in and get the pies, and they were all arriving, and obviously there's no grub tea because everybody's still out of the game. Aye. So it was. I know. I thought he looked all right that first game, but whatever. It's kind of stood the test of time, as you say. People are remembering him as one of Gaza's finest games or something. Like that. I just wasn't. It was.
I mean, I think that the performance. I don't want to be on this, but the performance he put in at McDermott Park probably ended his Celtic career. Recently there, you know, because he gets a start and he's hooked after 45 minutes after really doing absolutely nothing.
Really?
And I think that's probably the last you'll ever see him, like, you know.
So what do we reckon with some of the signings? What do we think of Pookie? Do we think Pookie will still be there next year?
You know what, I think Pookie's actually starting just a wee bit to look a bit better. I mean, I personally think that his biggest problem is he wants too much time on the ball in a league that he just didn't get time on the ball. But certainly, if you take that St. George's game just mentioned, you know, as a barometer, him, Baldy and Borrector, he was the only one that showed up half decent. The other two were absolutely hopeless. But at the same time, you're looking at Stokes, you're looking at Griffiths, you're saying you're probably going to have a potential replacement for Samaras. If Celtic get a decent offer for Pookie, you know, can you see them turning it down? I'm not sure I can, to be honest.
No, I would kind of agree. And what do you think, Big Baldy? I just don't think, I gave him the benefit of the doubt, but he just doesn't even look like a football player, does he?
You know, he's fleeting appearances and whatever, but I mean, again, it's St. Johnstone, he just wasn't at the races. And, you know, there's a rawness about him, which is fine, but like you think after being a year at Celtic, training every day with the kind of players, the kind of coaches, you'd have done something. But I don't think Celtic have got the patience to think, you know, we can pay this guy, whatever it is, 10 grand a week, when we could probably get £1 million for him in the summer and just get rid of him, like, you know.
You think we'd get £1 million for him?
Well, I mean, to be honest, I very much doubt that we paid the fee that was bandied about at the time, which I believe is about 1.7 million, because Celtic just didn't do that, you know what I mean? And so I think if we get anything up towards the half a million to a million, I think they'll be fine. But, you know, I'm always of the opinion of players like that, it's like I'd rather see a young player being developed, because don't forget, you've got Tony Watt coming back as well. And it's, you know, I'd rather see a young player being developed through that and taking Baldy's position on the bench at the very least, rather than just having him sit there and kind of play these wee cameo roles and bit parts. And I think in any kind of football sort of orientation, no matter where it is, the less players play, the better they become in the eyes of the fans.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
And that certainly happened with Amido Baldy.
Absence makes the heart grow fonder.
Yeah.
Big Bobo Baldy was the best thing since Fred. You know, he was at the team for a while.
Aye.
He just turned into Franco Baresi.
That is true, Nicholas. Because you always want to see him like, and again, it's one of those underdog things as well, going like him, he'll come good. And I backed Pookie for quite a while, going as a player in there, But I'm looking at him now going, I'm not too sure. And even with Kyle, I was like, this guy's the business. And see now, every time I see him come on the pitch, I'm just like, ooh, I could just prepare to get angry because I know he's going to piss me off.
Well, the other thing is we're going to have two new strikers with two new sets of hair.
Oh, Griffiths and Stokes just shake their heads, yeah.
So what's this? I've missed this.
Both of them have went for the old Wayne Rooney jobs, you know.
Oh, have they?
Which, in fairness, they had to. They were fucking fooling nobody, like, you know what I mean? They're both going bald. I mean, seriously bald. So, may as well just shave it off and do a Zinedine Zidane and at least be decent about it.
What about, has anyone heard that, what was that rumour doing the rounds about Finn Boxing? That Tony Watt was getting used as bait to get Finn Boxing, that was getting resurrected.
I was just going to bring up Finn Boxing there a second ago. Was it last season they were humming and hawing over him, was it the season before? Yeah,
last season,
eh? Is he not like one of the top scorers in Europe now this season?
Yep.
Like number three?
He's still with Ian Dean, isn't he?
Yeah. Somewhere he said he's leaving, like, but
I read that somewhere that he's the third highest scorer in Europe at the moment.
I think one of the reasons why this has kept going is because he was brought up in Edinburgh. His father had a job over here, and he played for a team called Hutchie Vale, supported Hibs. And I was really fat. I think his high school education was in Edinburgh, basically. And so you'll kind of know the score and stuff, but Celtic are renowned for this. You know, there's always players that seem to always get linked. I mean, we were linked with Robbie Keane for about 15 years before he actually came, you know. And you know, various. I mean, the even going back to the Tommy Burns era with the Mark DeGrazi and all this kind of thing. And I don't know. It's, again, Finn Balson will probably be one of these players who will be Marco Van Basten until he actually signs, and everybody will probably think he's shite after three games. You know,
this team. You know, one of the ones I used to love every year would come up, and I still throw it out there just to see if anybody has forgotten who this guy is. Used to, every year there'd be a link to Georgie Kinkladze. Every year I just still throw it out, going, I think they're going to sign Kinkladze. So
well, to go through it, something I thought about, we're talking about Danny McGrain there, and obviously Big Johans here. What kind of coaches are you looking for? To kind of take certainly Johan's place. I mean, what kind of, do you think this is something that we could maybe get a wee bit cute with and bring in, you know, a kind of top talent here?
When you say top talent, do you mean somebody who's actually a manager?
Well, what I mean is, I'll give you an example, right? Obviously, the FA Cup final there on the weekend, and the big criticism of Arsene Wenger is that this is a guy who was very innovative when he first came to Arsenal, the diet, the nutrition, the yoga, all that kind of thing. And what's basically happened is everybody's caught up with that, and now he doesn't really know how to do anything about it. And one of the things is he never brings in coaches. He's still the coach of the players. And I just thought that, you know, maybe we could be looking at something a wee bit differently here in terms of a coach. I mean, Alex Ferguson continually changed his coaches from Steve McLaren, Carlos Queiroz, Rennie Mullenstein, Mike Phelan. Aye, I mean, they continue. I mean, he even had Walter Myth there and whatever. Right. So is this something that we could actually look at and say, rather than just go for the obvious, well, you know, Lenny played with him, so we'll have him. You know, maybe we could actually, maybe we could actually employ somebody, you know, a foreign type of coach or whatever, you know, just to help us out, like.
You got to imagine that when Neil Lennon's been doing all these badges and stuff, he's made enough contacts to have, you know, access to somebody who's, you know, really, really good. I mean, I can imagine doing all, you know, don't all these guys mix on these coaching courses? Isn't this what it's all about?
Definitely, but I think, and a perfect example of this was at Hearts this season. You know, they had John Robertson there, who volunteered his services for nothing as a coach. And it was obvious to every Hearts supporter and anybody watching the telly that Gary Locke couldn't stand having John Robertson anywhere near him. Because that there's a club legend who, if you kind of do the job, the fans will just say, aye, get him in right away, you know?
Yeah, the pressure's on already,
aye. Aye, and I think that would be happening if Lenny was like, or, you know, the club were like, why don't we get Henrik Larsson as a coach? Manager, we'll sell season tickets off the back of that. I'm sure the manager's thinking, aye, and if I fuck up the first 3 months, I'm out of a job and he gets it.
Yeah.
See, but I think what you need to be careful as well is you need somebody that can speak English.
Mm.
You know, I think coming to work here, it's imperative if you're the coach, you need to be able to speak the language. So if you're looking at a foreign coach, you want somebody that can sort of speak the language. But no, I'm with you, Paul. If there's somebody out there, I'm not an aficionado myself, I find it, play people abroad, but if there is someone out there that can speak English and could bring a bit of innovation to the club, I would certainly go for it. But you make a good point with Ferguson, because he's must have been about 10.
Aye. And I think, look, the bottom line is, we're going to win the league this season. We all know that. The Cups, we hope to get back in a boot and bring them back to Celtic Park as well. And obviously, we want to be in the Champions League. But nothing we're going to really do. We're not going to go out and spend 25 million quid to get in the Champions League. That's just never going to happen. We know that. What I think we could do, though, is we could be bringing in a coach that could be actually developing players, or has a history developing maybe even younger players or whatever. Because that's, at the end of the day, for a club like us, that has to be our be-all and end-all. We can't buy the ready-made product. We need guys who have a track record in making players who are at the club right now better. And if we can bring in a coaching staff like that, it'll only benefit us. And even, you know, if you're spreading out to a foreign coach who can speak English and does know the European game, you know, what a help it could be in the Champions League. You know, just that wee bit extra, something that wee bit different, you know?
Yeah, and pay them top dollar. You know what I mean? You're not looking for somebody in $2,000 a week or whatever. So if you're getting a top-class foreign coach, some like Robert Prozanetsky or something like that, I don't know. But if you're getting somebody in there that's at a top-class European pedigree, pay them the top dollar, because you should get the money, the money's worth out of them, you know, for what they should bring to the, sort of bring to the table.
Well, but I mean, it baffles me. If you look at Scottish football right now, I mean, there's Jim Duffy getting the Morton job today. You're thinking, Jim Duffy, you know, is that a level of your kind of thought process, your imagination? Tommy Craig, the Black Widow, gets the St Mirren job. I mean, Christ almighty. It's just like, what are they thinking about? And it's just all about, like, who can we get as a cheap option? Yeah. But surely a better option is to go to somebody who's maybe done a wee bit coaching here, there and everywhere. I mean, you've got the boy, Ian Cathrow, that was at Dundee United, who's pretty much the guy that they credit with finding gold and suiting that kind of thing. He's currently in Portugal, manager of Rio Avenue, I think it is, highly rated. And that's kind of what Ferguson did. When Ferguson brought Steve McLaren into Man United, he'd never even met him. But he just went to them and said, who's the best coach in the game right now? And they said, Steve McLaren. And that just went for... They were up against pretty much the French World Cup winning side at Arsenal and, you know, had to do something different. Brought McLaren in and they won the treble the following season.
Yeah. I mean, you look at McLaren and you look at also the current England manager, like Roy Hodgson, he made his name abroad. Yeah. You know, these are guys, he's went everywhere, he succeeded nearly everywhere he's went, he just went about his business quietly. The Scottish guy, Stuart Baxter, I don't know, has he ever done anything in Scotland? But he done really well abroad. You know, and it's...
I don't think he's ever been in Scotland, but I mean, you've got the under-17s there, and then the under-19s are playing for Scotland in the last couple of weeks. And last year, I mean, they're fully Celtic players. You know what I mean? And you can be looking at saying, like, how do we... You know, just a different voice and all that kind of thing to just say, right, this is something we could look at. Because at the end of the day, players, when you hear about managers, when Moyes bumped to Man United, the first thing that always comes out is, oh, the players hated the training, you know? And it's like, you know, I'm a wee bit like, well, fucking, you know, it must be a nightmare to go in for 2 hours a day and 200 grand a week, you know? But, you know, get a grip of yourself. But at the same time, you know, we could be progressing it in terms of... being that just a wee bit different because, you know, Mialbi, Lennon, Parker, and then to a lesser extent, McGrain. Mialbi, Lennon, Parker all knew each other. They're all big. But, I mean, Gary Parker's here because he's a mate of Lenny's. There's no doubt about that. Yeah. But, like, maybe Lenny could actually learn for a guy. Because, I mean, I don't know how good a coach Lenny is. I've no idea. But what I would imagine, and I probably have a real good guess, is he's a fantastic motivator. You know what I mean? Right. Because he knows the club, he knows the fans, he knows the expectations, and he can tell you what it's all about. Similarly, I think he's calmed down a lot in the last couple of years. You know,
I think Lenny knows FIPA as well. Because see when you're listening to him, see when he's on like Match of the Day or whatever, you know, he's a treat to listen to, you know, because he's very, very knowledgeable about the game. But I think you're right, mate, and it's like, him, Mialbi and Gary Parker, none of them are going to bring something new to the party because they're all kind of, they've grew up together and they've done the same kind of thing. I'm with you, mate. I think that'd be really good.
Because you've already got John Park there, right? So you've got a setup where, you know, Park's gone out there scouting the players and, you know, whatever. And by all accounts, you know, I was finding out a couple of more things about John Park recently that, you know, John Park was a guy who, was at Glasgow Cali University and all that kind of thing, and then had known Alec McLeish. McLeish took him to Motherwell, then he took him to Hibs, and then he wanted to take him to Rangers, and Park said no. He was quite happy to stay at Hibs. And then Park effectively ran that club when Mowbray was the manager, to the extent where it was John Park who actually convinced Gordon Strachan to buy Scott Brown rather than Kevin Thompson. So, you know, that was the kind of level that he was operating at. So if Park, I mean, because I'm for all the abuse that Levine and that got last week, and rightly so, because I think, you know, all these guys that were loyal to Hertz and took wage cuts, and it's like, aye, thanks for that, and it was piss off. They have got the right idea, I think, in terms of, you know, promoting, why do you need, when you lose one manager, why do you then have to sack all the coaching staff and then bring in another set of coaching staff at a cost of an absolute fortune? You know, where the progression should come through the ranks. And if we should be kind of looking at our coaches and saying, right, is there anybody there who's going to be in our, could be our first team coach in the next couple of years, whether it's John Kennedy, Chris McCart, Frail, whoever. And if they're not, then really we should be looking at moving them on. You know, because at the end of the day, if we can get a conveyor belt of coaches, and that's why I, you know, I was advocating a couple of weeks ago, get somebody like Gordon Strachan to run the whole thing. Because if there's one thing Strachan loves doing, it's coaching and trying to make players better and that kind of thing. Then you're effectively going to run a system where you're implementing your players through the system as much as you can, and you're also implementing the coaches. And so they're going to know each other and all that kind of thing. And surely that can only benefit the club, you know?
Yeah, when you just look at the difference in the Scottish national team since Rhys Strachan's took over, it's night and day, you know. There's a confidence about them, and you actually believe that Scotland could do something, you know, coming up to European Championships. You think it's no beyond the realms of possibility of them qualifying, because he's getting them to produce performances that I didn't think they were capable of doing. But on paper, no, the greatest players in the world, but he's definitely getting something extra out of them, and I'm delighted for him, because I think the world is Strachan. But somebody like that, I would love for Strachan to play a part in Celtic going forward.
To me, it'd be ideal, simply because, you know, he's effectively in a part-time job right now, right? And that's a guy who wants to be on the training pitch every single day. But the one thing we all know that Strachan hates is he hates the media spotlight. You know, he hates having to answer questions and all that kind of thing. And that's where you get a lot of the kind of answers for him that are sometimes funny, sometimes sound a bit crabby and whatever. Yeah. You put that guy in there and set up. I mean, he's the honorary president of Spartans, which is the team that my eldest son plays for. Mm-hmm. And Strachan kind of implemented a whole system where it was fines for bookings, it was all this different thing, and every team plays the same way right through. And now, of course, they have a passage from next season through the Lowland League that could actually make them into the actual top leagues in Scotland. And one of the great things that Strachan did was, just a quick story about him, was that at the Player of the Year Awards a couple of years ago, one of the guys at Spartans was like to Gordon, "Oh, come along and, you know, would you present the trophies for all the different age groups?" And Strachan says to him, "Do you know what, mate? I didn't really agree with young kids getting trophies and that." He says, "Because I didn't think it does them any good. But what I will do is, I'll come along and I'll do a coaching session for every single team you've got." And the guy never phoned them back. And since what Strachan said after that was, "You know what that's about?" He says, "That guy just wants me to sit beside him on the night and act like the big man and talk football with me all night." He says, "And I'm not interested in that." And that's his firm belief of Strachan, is that, you know, coaching. I mean, to me, it's ridiculous to go on a tangent here, that in this country right now, for you to be a recognised coach with your badges, it'll cost you $5,000.
I know.
And in Spain, it'll cost you £500. And yet we look at Spain, who are going for their fourth international tournament in a row, and still the penny Disney drop.
Right. You know, and I always think as well, managers in this country, it's the only profession in the world that you can be absolutely shite at, but you'll still get another job. You know, it's like abject failure, and they'll be queuing up to give you your next job. And then you've got somebody like Danny Lennon there, with a club like St Mirren. He gets them a major trophy, keeps them in the Premier League, and they get rid of him to bring in Tommy Craig.
Aye.
I mean, if you've just arrived for the planet Zooton or something like that, and you're watching that, and you're saying, what's going on there?
I mean, one of these guys there's always these guys that just turn up everywhere. One of, in England, it's always Ian Dewey. He just appears all the time. And I actually witnessed him about 6 months ago. He was talking about his career and that kind of thing, and he actually said the sentence, "I'm proud of my record at Newcastle," when he was there with Shearer. They played 8 games, they lost 7, and he's proud of that record. When they went, the last game of the season, they went to Villa Park, all they needed was a win to stay up. They never had one shot on target that day. And yet, guaranteed, some half-wit with too much money will go to a club and say, "Aye, we'll get Ian Dewey, he's a great coach," you know what I mean?
I think when he said he was proud of his record at Newcastle, I think he did Bagan Vogels on Fog in the Town.
But it's incredible, man. They always bum each other up on the telly. There are plenty of good managers out there just waiting for that phone call. You're like, are they good? You know, it's just like, what have they done? And it just, I don't know, it just beggars belief.
I think, like, you know, being a football manager, especially in England, you've got to portray a bit of a powerful illusion, like, you know what I mean? Going, I know what I'm doing, but you fucked up your last job. Yeah, you know, but it wasn't my fault, it was their fault, the players are shit. Have your jobs to make them better. Ah, but listen, what am I meant to do? Be a manager?
Well, the current Allardyce is one of the highest paid in the league, you know.
And he's got, I mean, he's huge. Opinion he sell, you know, if I was called Sam Allardyce, I'd be managing Real Madrid now and all this kind of thing. I mean, right now in Scotland, the media darling's Derek McInnes. Now, we can all say right away, well, they won the trophy and that, and they've not done anything since, and Motherwell pipped them and blah, blah, blah. But to me, I mean, apart from the fact that there's a disproportionate amount of Aberdeen fans in our media, Derek McInnes, his record, to me, does not stand up to scrutiny or what he's actually done with the club. First of all, has he implemented anything for the future? No. I mean, he went out and paid £500-600 a mere to get players like Robson and Flood, who are at the back end of their careers. How many times have they scored 4 goals this season? Once. So, but this is a guy that's got... Meanwhile, you know, Tommy Wright wins the first trophy in St Johnstone's history. Stuart McCall gets Motherwell 3rd season in a row to 2nd in the league. You know, Jackie McNamara gets Dundee United Cup final. And, you know, you can see the progression in their teams. You can see the plan. But Derek McInnes, oh, aye, he's brilliant, this, that, next thing. Well, because he's got 2 plodders in the middle of the park who can make them hard to beat. You know, and that's the thing with Scottish football. Like, we didn't encourage progressive managers, you know?
Yeah, see to me, like, you've got the argument is, should the manager of the year be the league winners? Which I can kind of understand why people don't want to give it to Lenny because of the, obviously, disproportionate resources and things like that. But to me, head and shoulders above everybody else for the is Stuart McCall. I just think what he's achieved with Motherwell, we're losing like his full team at the end of every season, and he rebuilds it and he still gets them 2nd in the league. But then you look back to that, they probably had one of the worst results in their history against Albion Rovers in the cup competition. Mm. But Lenny can cite that as well, obviously, with us getting out to Morton and stuff like that. But I just think what Stuart McCall's achieving on, you couldn't even call it a shoestring budget. He hasn't got any budget. And I just think it's nothing short of phenomenal. And when it's because Derry McInnes brung 40,000 fans to Celtic Park, is that why you get manager of the year?
I know. It's, and I believe what I've heard is the reason McCall's never got bigger jobs is because he's a kind of old school manager. But the flip side, you know, he's kind of like, he's not so much kind of the sort of modern game. He's very much up and at him, which is fine. But then the flip side of that is John Hughes has got jobs at Hibs and Inverness because he went in and done PowerPoint presentations about what he's got to do and all that kind of thing. And I personally think he's the biggest charlatan that's ever walked the face of the earth in management. You know, he sees the same cliched crap every single week. Meanwhile, he had a team that was 2nd in the league that he took over that he's kind of just dismantling, and they barely finished 5th. So, you know, it's a good time, I think. If I was a support, I mean, it's like, you take the current situation at Easter Road as an example, right? You know, Terry Butcher has been an absolute disaster.
Yep.
But you'll never read that in the media because, it's big Terry and all that kind of thing.
Yep.
Frank Zozzi, who is, you know, a Hibs legend, got half the time with better results than Terry Butcher's had, and they got rid of him.
Right. Pat Fenlon wouldn't have them in that position.
Well, it's funny.
No time whatsoever with Hibs.
Aye. And I'll tell you something else. What's actually now become apparent is Pat Fenlon actually done a far better job than people realise with 8 players.
Aye, exactly. Exactly. And he's been speaking about Hibs in the Irish media and stuff like that. And it's, you think to yourself, there is people out there, like you did mention John Hughes, and I've got a soft spot for Big Yoli because he played with us. But you do look at it, and he's just nothing but failures followed him when he's sort of managerial. Alec McLeish was another one. I know he won a treble with Sevco, well, with the old Rangers. But if you look at every other team, he was an impact manager. He took over other managers' teams. Like when he went to Motherwell, his first season was brilliant, but then after that, he nearly took them down. When he went to Hibs, I think his first season was brilliant again, but then when he brought his own players in, they were shocking. I don't know if he won the treble like his first year at Rangers, then they were useless. And then you've seen what he done with Birmingham City and then Villa. You know, that's a guy that just... I know the amount of money he made out of the game must be a multi-millionaire.
Okay, and I'm sure, like, if you go for a job in the Scottish media, then one of the first things they'll ask you in an interview, you know, the top papers, whatever, is, you know, who could you pick up the phone right now to as a contact? And I'm sure that applies with managers. And the fact that he could see Alex Ferguson would probably have stood him, you know, when he's basically certainly the godfather of British football.
Yeah.
That's brilliant. He's got, you know, Sir Alex here and all that kind of thing. But as you say, it's right. And then, of course, see, when they're no in jobs, they get... They sit down with fucking Chris Kamara on the Sunday morning, and then their own sports sound, and he would be basically just putting a commercial on for an hour and a half saying, "I need a job."
Tim Sherwood did that, didn't he? He just got sacked, and he was on Sky Sports the following couple of days later, talking about getting sacked. I mean, didn't Gus Poyet get sacked on TV?
Yes, that's right.
He didn't know anything about that. I mean, he's done some job at Sunderland. He's turned in right round about. I mean, I think it's somebody like that you're talking about, Paul. See, someone, like some South American that's played in the UK, that's got a good handle of the language, that can bring something different to the party. Because when you look at that, Marcelo Bielsa, he's took the Marseille job. He's got a legacy in world football. Anyone that he's touched have took on like his ideals about how he's got this. He plays, it's a very, very attacking, a very high tempo type game. But Roberto Martinez, there's been loads of managers have actually modelled themselves on the way. It's like Bielsa's got his own sort of style. And this is going to be the first time ever, the Marseille job, that he's took a job out with a Spanish-speaking nation. You know, so it'll be interesting to see how he does. But he doesn't do any, he's totally eccentric as well. There's no press, there's no interviews, there's nothing. But he's got a legacy through world football, and he's a legend in South America. And now there's loads of folk have just based themselves on him and his philosophy of playing football. But not to that degree, but I'd love, as you've said, I'd love to see us getting a vision of someone for another culture just to bring something different to the party. I would absolutely love that.
I think, like, if take you back to when Mowbray got bombed out, and then we're kind of like, there's managers out there right now that you need to take a chance on, right? And if we had the three candidates that were in the summer of 2010 that were Brendan Rodgers, Roberto Martinez, and the boy that's at Southampton right now, you'd give reasons for all the fans to say why we shouldn't go for them. Yeah. And now look at them. You know what I mean? And suddenly, Martinez, you know, he got relegated with Wigan. And people are like, oh, I'm not really sure. And he won the FA Cup. And then suddenly, it just looks like it fits perfectly. And Rodgers, you know, first time at Liverpool, he's kind of like, all these grand plans, oh, I'm not really sure about him. And then suddenly, it just starts to work. And because, you know, you have to be able to actually take a chance. I mean, the boys of Hampton as well, I mean, they're absolutely different class. Look at the players they're coming through. And sometimes you need to be able to take that chance. I mean, I think that we kind of let ourselves do in that respect at times when, you know, like half of Twitter told you last week Lenny would be the new Norwich manager by now. And then the candidates that we talk about for the replacement either all support Celtic or have played for Celtic. And you're kind of like, you didn't have to just play, you know. I'm sure, you know, we people are aware of Celtic now. You know, let's get a guy that can actually do the job.
Yeah.
Right. And the thing is, as well, it's up to Lenny, really, to actually, if he wants to further his career and he wants to build his own legacy, he should be the guy that's maybe wanting to learn from somebody else. Obviously, we're not telling him how to do his job. But I would say Lenny's effectively got the Celtic manager's job for as long as he wants it at the present, because I can't see he's no one in the league. You know, and if he can add one cup or potentially two cups and he can get his Champions League qualification next season again, the job's his, you know. And I think it'd be great for him to get somebody with just a different philosophy in football that's willing to be a coach, and Lenny can learn from them as well. But I think it's a great shout, Paul. I would totally advocate it, but obviously Lenny's the man. And just another thing, obviously with the rumours last week that Lenny's going to Norwich and stuff like that, do you see Lenny as the manager next season?
Well, I mean, I think that, you know, obviously people put two and two together and come up with five when Mialbi decided to go. And I think that, but what I've heard about that is that there was just, the relationship wasn't as strong as it was at the start. And you know what? That can happen. You live in somebody's pocket for 4 years, then, you know, you can get a bit pissed off, whatever. I think Lenny was, my own personal opinion is, he still harbours ambition in a Premiership job. But I think he was a lot closer to leaving last season than he is this season. Because, you know, it might just be the fact that if you look at the players that have come through in the last 6 months, that at the end of the day, it's like, you know what, we've suddenly evolved a team here, and this could be actually doing something. That being said, his salary isn't that great, relatively. I mean, it's all about 400 grand a year, which of course we know is half of what McCoy's gets. That would treble in the Premier League or whatever. Believe it or not, and take people's mind back, he isn't that wealthy a man. He lost £3 million in a court case about 3 years ago. So, you know,
did he?
Aye, it was a whole kind of Irish. It was an Irish investment thing, and it was ended up being some fraudulent scheme. But he lost his money for that. So, you know, I don't think he's quite at the Chris Sutton bankruptcy stage. But you know, I mean, I still think that if he got the right kind of offer, he would probably go, because I think the way managers look at it is there's only what 20 teams in the Premier League, 20 jobs. And Mace managers probably wouldn't get seven or eight of them. You know, Mace managers wouldn't get the Chelsea job, they wouldn't get the Man City jobs, or even Everton, and you know, because in Arsenal and all that kind of thing. But you know what? I think going back to what I was saying about Rodgers, Martinez, and people like that, there might just be one guy who thinks maybe this is the next one.
I think with them, but. With Martinez and Rodgers, they both served their apprenticeship in England with like lower teams, and I think that's what would maybe hold Lenny back for getting like an Everton type role, you know, that he hasn't got any experience in managing in England. And I just think his maybe thinking as like someone like a Norwich or the similar type sort of stature of a team, that would be his stepping stone to get in the bigger role. But you're obviously taking a big gamble there as well, because if you go there and you make an arse of that, 6 months down the line, you're in the scrap heap.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like, you're not going anywhere for there. Maybe your next move after Norwich is maybe Scunthorpe United or something like that.
Aye. And you're
having to start again.
The way football is now, man, you're easily forgotten pretty quickly.
Aye.
You know, all the managers and even players who are, you know, hot to drop 1 minute and the next minute, and everybody's like, oh, whatever happened to him? Whatever happened to him? And you just never know. And I think that's he's probably in his mind as well. But as you say, I mean, because that championship, I mean, I watch highlights at best, but like, it seems an incredibly hard league to get away.
Aye, big time.
You know, hugely. I mean, it was a 46 game season, and you know, then you've got playoffs, and oh, Christ almighty.
And you've got teams like Middlesbrough, Notts Forest, Leicester, Derby. You've got all these teams they're all big, big, big clubs. Yeah. You know, you've got Sheffield Wednesday, Sheffield United, Leeds. You've got these teams that are below the top level, and they are big, big clubs, QPR, you know, and it's, you say to yourself, you could take any one of them. You know, and it's you look at the. I mean, that's a big thing about Celtic. You know, we're obviously hard and ambitious to go and play in England, but can you imagine? You say to Celtic, right? We've gone to England, right, the promised land, but we don't get European football for another 15 to 20 years.
Mm.
You know, how would people like that? I think people wouldn't be long getting fed up with it.
No, I agree. It'd be a hard sell to get us all through all the leagues. I know people might say, oh, big picture now, but European football, I think, is what defines Celtic Football Club in a lot of respects on the pitch. I know in England as well, I mean, just ask your opinion on this. I don't know if you saw the figures that came out last week about what the clubs made for the Premier League positions. Cardiff City, 64 million at the bottom, Man City, 96.5 at the top.
Everton was 80 odd million quid. You just say yourself, bloody, we get 1 million. You know what? I just think, see, to be honest with you, see taking the blinkers off, and we've slagged Peter Law on this show countless times, but it's times when you look at figures like that, you realise that obviously there's loads of things they could do better, and we've mentioned loads of it here, but you kind of have to take your hat off that we're still functioning as a club and we're still competing in Europe. All right, we're not going to win the Champions League, but we get to the group stages, we have the odd decent result, we get some good trips away, and you just think to yourself that it's a bit of a minor miracle, really, you know, when you look at what we're up against.
Well, I mean, I think if you look at our turnover compared to, I mean, our turnover's still comparable with about probably much after the top six or whatever in England, our turnover's comparable, and yet their money's basically handed to them, and our money comes right out the supporters' pockets.
Yeah.
I mean, it's absolutely incredible, and it's, you know, looking at we're talking about the Champions League seasons and stuff. I mean, you know, you've got Liverpool's in group three. I mean, there's a pretty good chance we'd be playing a Premiership club should we get to the, you know, the last 32 the Champions League, and therefore, but yet I didn't think we would feel any kind of inferiority complex.
No, but it was not our own. But you've mentioned it loads of times, Paul, and it's like, I was arguing with a couple of, I think it was a Motherwell supporter, and it was about, they're comparing Celtic to Man City, how the money we've got, and they're like, wait a minute here, we don't have any sugar daddy, we don't have MD that's ploughing their cash into Celtic. We are self-sufficient, it's our supporters that put the money into our coffers. And we're actually running a ship when we're living within our means and we're living within our budget. We don't owe anybody anything. How can you compare us to a team where a sugar daddy that just comes in and just opens up a blank checkbook and just starts spending money that's going out of fashion? We've got a chief exec that balances the books and runs Celtic the way it can run. So all the players we've got, we deserve to have the players because our fans fund that. We fund everything that we are doing, so we compete at a European stage. As I say, we're not going to win it, but we still compete on a European stage on a yearly basis. But it's all down to how we run our club, and it's not down to anybody giving us handouts. We don't get handouts for anybody.
No, that's right. And I mean, look, I had done a gig in Denny last month, and I was a guy totally disagreed with me, but I said that for me, the difference with football is, football's not about success, it's about glory. Football, success can be bought, and Manchester City have proved that, right? They just go out and spend £1 billion on players, and eventually the success came. This is a club who Gary Cooper, ex-chief executive, admitted last week they were almost bankrupt in 2008. Then obviously Abu Dhabi came in, boom, £1 billion. They bought success. You cannot buy glory. And glory comes by putting up with the shit and everything that gets flung at you, no matter if you're Albion Rovers, Celtic, or anybody, for when that moment comes when you can earn a right. And similarly, when we got the trophy last Sunday, I read a couple of tweets, not for Celtic fans, on Twitter last week, which was like, oh, well, Celtic, would you expect? Of course they would win the league and all that kind of thing. And I just thought, you know what? Fuck you. We had a decade of misery where we were cheated at every opportunity by a team that masqueraded dignity and sporting integrity when we knew it was all complete and utter rubbish. And I'm going to celebrate every single one of them because we've earned the right. And as you say, we never overpaid to do it. We ran the thing properly. We brought our own players through. And now, so what? We're bearing the fruits of that. We're winning leagues and all that kind of thing. And yet, even in the media, you hear it yourselves every day. It's almost like we should be sorry for that. There's no competition and we win the league every year. All right, so we should be sorry for buying the best players and getting good value and bringing our players through and selling them on and kind of running the club like an actual business that has a football team, you know? That's how you have to do it in modern football. Yet, we get slagged for that. I just didn't get it.
I know. And you've got fans of other clubs saying, oh, obviously you'll win it. Neil Lennon, that's not an achievement for him doing it. Of course it is.
Yeah.
You're winning the league. Then they say Walter Smith's them and the old Rangers get 9 in a row. I mean, we were finishing 5th and stuff like that. They didn't have much of a challenge. They were signing the England bloody national team and they were signing them, paying them dodgy EBTs and stuff like that and doing every trick in the book to get these players, and we're doing everything by the book and living within our means, but it's deemed that we've sort of got an unfair sporting advantage. No, we've got an unfair advantage with more fans than the rest of these.
The last time this talk about the competition and all that arose was when Celtic won 9 in a row, and what did they do? They changed the league. A league that was producing teams that were competing in European finals and long runs in Europe. And, you know, where Kilmarnock had a good side, the Hunts had a good side, Aberdeen had a good side, Hibs had a good side, Hearts had a good side. The SPL came along and all the teams just basically died. They were never, ever, ever as good as they ever were. I mean, Hearts almost went bankrupt a few years later. Hibs have never been the same since. And it was like, so why did you need it? Oh, because Celtic are winning every other year. And it always seems to be as, oh, because if it's Celtic, then it's different than Canny. And it's no wonder the kind of Bears are all jangling right now, because Celtic are actually looking invincible in Scotland. You know, we've got a team. I mean, we finished like 30 points clear. Yeah, but as you say, anybody who thinks it's easy, then they've never watched football. You know what I mean? You've got to earn the right to do that. You know, and we saw last season how much crap we could watch and. how many points we could drop and so on and so forth. You know, it's not our fault there's no challenge, you know what I mean? We played by the book the entire time.
Yeah. No, absolutely. Long may it continue. I'm not getting fed up with it. I'm no sorry. You know, I'm just loving it. And that's the thing that you've got a lot of sort of, I know the internet bandpot community, you've got some, it's quite cool to slate everything to do with Celtic now, but by God, I'm loving it at the minute. You know, I make no apology for that, for loving seeing Celtic winning leagues, you know, and it's, for years and years growing up, there were so many barren years, and you were getting downtrodden, and your team were, they were getting out and buying everybody, and the three teams at the start of the leagues and stuff, we could field three teams, and you just knew you were getting nothing at the end of the day. But now the tables have turned, and I'm loving it, and I make no apologies for that.
Joel, I was just going to say, clearly there's issues that need ironed out off the park, but I would say again that fans need to remember we are the club, and we are the identity of the club, and we're the one that protect the ethos. Should never expect anything from boards, chief executives, or anything like that, because they all fuck us over eventually. You know, we've had so much stuff about Fergus McCann recently, and it's like, you'd think the fans were chanting one Fergus McCann every week. That never happened. He'd done a lot of good stuff, but he frustrated the hell out of us as well. You had, you know, Desmond White when they're pissing you if you're on fire. You know, Tom, these guys done nothing for us. They never done anything for us, and they never will. You know what I mean? We are the club, and if the fans realise that, there's nothing that anybody within the club can do to stop that, or ever will, because the fans are the staple. They're the consistent. We'll be there long after anybody at boardroom level or whatever else, you know?
And you would think this sort of fans revolting against the board was a new thing. Because when have the fans ever had a cosy relationship with the upper echelons of the club? It's never happened.
No, it's not. It never has. I mean, it's, you might be a select few that they've always, you know, had various things going on with the club and whatever. But by and large, you know, I can't ever remember a time when everybody's been like, oh, the board are absolutely fantastic. You know, we've always had issues with every single board that's ever worked. And I think what happened in 94 has made it even tenfold. It's, we just basically are suspicious of everybody at boardroom level. And rightly so, because at the end of the day, we are the people who will scrutinise them, and we are the people that they're accountable to, you know?
I think we just lost the caller a second ago. Somebody called in, I forgot to talk to them. Whoever that was, I apologise completely. I was daydreaming there. We've been joined by a caller. I'm just sitting back listening to you and Paul talk to each other. Joe Martin's on the line. Joe?
I thought you were talking to yourself there for a minute.
Are you there, Joe? Are you there? No? Saying it, Joe?
No.
Sorry, is that there? He's something wrong.
His voice come up.
All right, I can see him on his bike. I'll try and call him back.
So what have you heard then about pre-season stuff? That there was rumours about playing San Pauli
aye, they're playing Rapid Vienna on the 6th of July, which, you know, there's one to be in at the board about, for fuck's sake. and then they've penciled in St Pauli on the 26th of July. We're playing Tottenham in Helsinki on the 2nd of August. I mean, a guy came up and he says, "Yous are playing Tottenham in Helsinki." I was like, wherever the money goes, we'll be there, you know.
I think we're not meant to play a German team, but they pulled out.
Aye, Bayer Leverkusen pulled out. Yeah. Now, the interesting thing, of course, is the 9th of August is when the SBFL starts, and we're going to be away from home because Celtic Park's not going to be ready after the Empire game. So that's going to be interesting, which I think means that I think they've penciled in Flag Day for the following week, but then that also is the opt-out game, which we've opted out of quite a few times to play in Dublin and that. So I don't know if there's anything being planned. There was rumours of playing Barcelona in Dublin. And, you know, I'll not name any names, but I had certain people in Dublin say to me, oh, for Christ's sake, could they not get somebody else? You know, rather than Barcelona, we always play them. I'm thinking, for fuck's sake, you're just going to be pissed whoever it is you play. You'll be fucking Real Falkirk, you know what I mean? You're still going to be on the Guinness all day anyway. It doesn't matter what fucking team's against us.
I think Barcelona are probably to fill the stadium, like, you know what I mean, as well.
Aye. Although I noticed, just then, and Jason, you might know more about this than me, there's going to be a massive clear out of players at Barcelona.
Is there?
So that's
Luis Enrique is basically listening to offers for Fabregas and all sorts of players, and they've cleared out quite a few as well.
We've had a phone, a caller. Caller, you there?
Hey, Joe.
Alistair, it's yourself.
How are you?
Did you call earlier and I just forgot to add you in?
No, it's a bit. I wanted to call, but. George Samaras.
Oh, right, okay, go ahead.
It was today where I thought they were done with the Lee Javis Bullion, but don't get me wrong, I think our Celtic player has got a shelf life, so I'm kind of glad to see him go, you know, and because I just think it's time. It's just, I think you can be a club too long. It's just I wanted to see what you guys thought, innit?
Listen,
I kind of agree with you, Alistair. I think it's, we kind of touched on it earlier about the when they're out the team, they suddenly become world beaters. I think everybody kind of agreed that Samaras had ran his race. And then he came in at the end of the season and people were getting a bit dewy-eyed and hoping he gets offered another contract. But nah, I'm quite happy to see. Thanks for his services. He was a good servant to the club. He was more frustrating than he was brilliant. But on his day, he was definitely our best player. But I'm quite happy to see the back of him. I don't know what Paul and Joe.
I said this recently that, I think you've mentioned this to me. If you go on YouTube and watch like Samaras' goal for Celtic, he scored some great goals, like he has. You know what I mean? Like, fair enough, and he's probably on a percentage, he's probably 60-40, 60 in the frustration zone, 40 in the, genius zone. But I think, listen, he always tried his best, I thought. I see a lot of this lying on the ground with his hands in the air because he got fouled. I used to hate that shit, and I still hate that shit. But, I mean, he seemed like a good guy. He took a pay cut to come to the club. He's clearly got a fondness for the club, you know. And I wish him all the best. And I think wherever he goes, he'll become a bit of a hero there as well, because the guy can score goals.
Well, Bucky's been taking all his back now, so he's got more goals than Samaras this season, so
somebody had it up on Twitter, right?
Goals, you know?
Somebody had it up on Twitter recently that they saw a Pookie in a supermarket and he looked depressed, and that must mean that he's not enjoying himself in Glasgow. Right? See, if you're paying that much of attention to somebody's life, you've got no fucking life of your own. Right?
Yeah. What do you think, Paul, about Samaras?
It's time for him to go. I'm not dewy-eyed about him at all. It's time for him to go. Definitely. I mean, he's a great servant and all that kind of thing. Loads of high moments, but time for him to go. We've got to move on.
Where do you reckon he'll go, Jason?
I've got no idea.
Spain?
I think he'll go to Spain.
I think he'll go to Greece. I have a funny feeling. See a guy like Samaras, right? He's a real likeable guy, real affable. I'd say a guy like him, go back to Greece, play for a decent-sized team, and then probably run for political office.
I think
Samaras is
Spanish
fitness,
no.
That's what I'm saying, that's why Samaras is going to go back and he's going to reinvent Greek football, and then he's going to smash some plates and make some money and become the president of Greece. That's the way I see it going. That's Joe's educated guess lane. You call any time. Alistair, we've got another caller on the lane, mate.
Right,
that one
is Joe.
Talk to
you
later, mate.
See,
hey,
a good break, guys. I'll see you later.
No problem.
Right,
easy, mate. Look, Joe Magan, are you there? Oh, Jesus, Joe. Come on. It's not working.
Stuff
he is there, like, but there's just no sound coming. You obviously
text him
there. Tell him to just call the phone line. Can be handier. Okay.
Yeah.
Isn't he in Glasgow?
It's in Glasgow, eh?
Oh, so there you go. So a local lane.
What's the number?
That's a good question. Hold on a second. Is there a phone call coming in there? No one. The phone number is 0141-356-7327.
0141-356.
356. 7327.
Oh.
Hello, who's this?
It's Joe.
Hey!
Joe, I was just texting you there and use the phone number.
Jesus. I think you'd think you'd have a ring. It looked as if I was on the call, but can you hear me, obviously?
Psychic, Joe Psychic. He knew the phone number from even texting to him. Joe, how you doing, mate?
How you all doing, all right?
I'm all right.
I'll not take up too much of a time base, but I just want to say thanks to you and everybody's for helping us, sort of thing.
Oh, absolutely. Pleasure.
No need to thank us. But tell you what, speaking of that, I want to talk about highlights of the year, because we've been talking about managers now for about 40 minutes, right? So I think it's time to talk about, you know, highlights of the year, right? Now, without a doubt, one of my highlights, probably the highlight, is probably the Kano dance. I mean, you know, was one of my highlights, and you know, everything that's happened involving the Kano through this show. I mean, just it's one of the highlights of this year, I think. You know,
see, to be fair, the past year has been fantastic. I mean, even a couple of weeks ago, we were nominated as the main benefactor in the Celtic Sport Association rally, and just to get that exposure to all the CSEs and things like that was just fantastic. You know what I mean? To actually recognise an official body. It's just phenomenal.
Brilliant. And what about the golf day? What date's that? Tommy's getting the golf day arranged.
Will be 12th of September at Mount Ellen again.
12th of September. And still places available?
There's actually about 50 odd names doing it at the moment.
Right.
So I don't know how many of the course will cut, is it? But it could be a bigger day. I know it's still early, right enough.
So is it £50 a head?
It's £50, right.
So if MD's contact us or tweet the Kano Foundation or whatever, and we'll put you across and whatever. So it's £50 a head. And by all accounts, I've not played in it yet, but everybody that's went to the previous years, I've absolutely loved it.
No, it's normally a cracking day. This year and all, we're trying to get the golf club all night as well. So we'll have a wee disco or something on after this sort of thing.
Right. And you got a few ex-players in that plane as well, don't you, Joe?
Aye, there's normally about 5-6 or so. Right?
Good.
So, do you play golf, Jason?
Me? Not really. No, I used to, but I don't really play.
There's actually quite a few that don't really play golf. They go and hit the ball out and have a laugh.
In fact, I seen you in the tour a couple of weeks ago. Both of you were in that golf lounge.
That's right, aye. That's seen you, aye. I was shite that night at all.
Aye, I was brutal too.
But this year has been, I don't know, it just took off so much this year. I mean, even the North American Federation have been brilliant with St. Catharines donated £250 for 5 season tickets next year. We're actually going to up our season tickets, did you know that, Jason? The moment would be 62. We're going to up it next year to 80. So that would let us take at least 70 kids every week in a cell partner rather than 52.
That's fantastic.
Brilliant, mate. Happy days. And I know my neighbour, the Clareland Boys Club, they were there at the final game of the season and they all had an absolute ball. So
I was there at the wee man's communion that day. The big Brian said they had their caps off and all that. We're all jumping about mental.
Andy Rose Clareland, it's very Celtic orientated, so there wouldn't have been any danger there.
We've all come to win to the ball, Martin McCullum and off, it's McKenna night.
That's right.
Things like that just blow you away, man.
I know, and all the money raised went to the Kano Foundation that night.
All the money went to the Rich McKenna, San Francisco. Memorial night from the Celtic Club and all the money went to Kano Foundation. It's just phenomenal for us. But I was listening earlier on and Paul was saying that the fans on the club, more true love couldn't be said, man. Doesn't matter how much you ask a club or want a club today, see if the fans are behind you,
That's it, mate. Aye. And the Celtic supporters are just, when we put our mind to something, you know, sort of unstoppable.
I mean, they're Celtic. I think Celtic announced today 16,000 for the bucket collection the other week. But how many people, when we did the bucket collection last year, hopefully it'll be the first game of the season next year again, first home game. But there's that many people do it every week, but there's so many people, the Celtic fans are helping at the moment, you know what I mean? So many different charities all chasing that one down. It's just along with the Celtic fans can actually do for each other, how they help each other.
I know. And as soon as it's mentioned that it's for a charity, but especially when it's for a charity that's close to their hearts, that's taking young kids to see Celtic, you know, everybody, even the people that didn't, I mean, because I'd done the bucket collection with you last year, and the odd person that came up, they didn't know what it was. They says, tell us, what is this Carol Foundation? And you explain to them, and they just dig deeper.
I know I'm bang on about it, but there's thousands and thousands of fans every week that don't know what they do. See what band, don't know what they do, they see the wings of the wee flags and things like that, scarves, they still don't know what they do. And it's hard, we try and promote as much as we can, but it's very hard, they're on the screens every week, people still don't know.
And it's for them that's listening in as well, that's got that take to do with any youth organisations or anything like that, and you want Do you know, contact the guys at thecanofoundation.com. Is it .co.uk or .com?
.com.
And just put your, there'll be a calendar up when the fixtures get announced, and just get your name in and see what game you can get and bring the kids along, because that's what it's there for. It's there for everybody. So more people, get, obviously with the more season tickets, Joe, you've got obviously more scope for more kids getting in.
We need more applications, that's right, for up in the intake.
Right. Brilliant, mate. So what was your highlights of the season on the park?
On the park, I thought it was... the one that stood out to me is actually disappointing. The Morton game and the Aberdeen game stood out to me. The rest of the season was kind of a level. You knew you were kind of a one in it. You knew you were a wee bit better. I said to step up, stepped up, do you know what I mean? So highlight for me, basically, the other side of it. I see. People getting behind it, weekend day for people, the group that came here for Belfast, even the Fearwood fans that came here, that was a brilliant weekend. They actually raised money for us and all. The Christmas party they had was just, that was just fantastic, man.
Yeah, it was great.
So things like that stood out to me. I think that only the park's been quite mediocre, you know what I mean?
Like, I don't know, with some the first game at Firth Park, I thought was great. The one obviously with the seats, but on the park it was brilliant. I thought with Big Samaras did it at Kilmarnock as well. That was a scorcher. And was that last season? Or was that last
Liam season?
Henderson, yeah, mm-hmm. Aye, Liam Henderson. But was that right at the start of the season, Paul? The Kilmarnock away game.
Aye. When he's
aye. I was thinking, I'm saying to myself, was that last season or this season? No, but they two games, the two away games, were really good. And but obviously, there was a Champions League. It was a bit disappointing. Qualifying was great, but I just thought we didn't really perform in the group stages. But I think we let ourselves down against a no too good Ajax side. That we went over there, and I thought they were kind of there for the taking, but nah, it wasn't to be.
I was disappointed with you because they basically played it after partner. They were far better than us, and they're sitting 9th, 10th in that week, so I thought we were going to be a better against them.
I thought we actually played no too bad earlier without putting the ball in the net, you know, and it's that was the time to get them because they were all over the shop at that time.
Yeah, I thought they played really well at Celtic Park, though.
Mm-hmm. Aye.
So,
you can't
not been in it. It's absolutely brilliant, isn't it?
I know.
The expectations supposed to be.
Because I fundamentally disagree with it because it's totally corrupt. Do you know what I mean? But you can't beat it. I just hate the corruption with UEFA and how the seeds work out and how no two teams for the same country can be drawn in the same pot. And everything's just geared to get those same 8 clubs every year at the final stages. You know, you can pick your Bayern Munich, your Barcelona, your Real Madrid, your Man United. Well, normally your Man United. But, you know, it's the same teams year in, year out. Your AC Milan, your Juventus. It's always the same teams that's at the final stages. And that's just the way UEFA want it. You know, the wee teams like us, we don't get much of a chance. But
you're talking about alone if you move to England, you wouldn't miss it. You wouldn't miss
the Champions League next. Oh, big time. Big time. Big time, that's one of the greatest things ever, is Celtic European nights. Forever I was a kid walking there with the floodlights on, and it's dark, and you can just sort of smell the stadium. And it's just, for being a kid, and it's still even, you still got a buzz when you're walking up there, and it's a midweek.
It's
a bit of
his own Bullenhovel show, that's one of our memories when
they're
younger.
Oh, no.
Getting to the European nights with the floodlights on and things like that.
Aye, it's just I think my first European game was I think it was Real Sociedad.
Aye,
that
was the first one.
I think it was Real Sociedad in 81. Was that 81, Paul? 80?
It was 82.
It was after we beat Ajax.
Ajax,
second round. Second round. And I think they drew with them at Celtic Park, didn't they? They beat them.
No, I think we beat them 2-1 at Celtic Park, and we got beat 2-0 or 3-0 over there.
2-0 over there, aye. That was my first game. That was my first European tie in the front of the main stand. And I can mind it, like, I was going to say I can mind it like yesterday, but this smell and everything's still there, you know. Just amazing times. And I went to quite a few Aarhus, and I can mind games like that, Dynamo Kiev and all that kind of stuff. And the European nights were fantastic. Dynamo Kiev was probably one of the biggest crowds I'd been in at that time, in the terrace and myself. You know, I was absolutely bunged that night. Was that night Tony Shepherd scored?
No, it was Judas. Judas Lines.
Aye. Who did Tony Shepherd score against?
Shamrock Rovers, I think, the round before.
Was it?
I think it was him and Judas scored in that game as well. And actually, that was in the second leg against Shamrock Rovers, we won 1-0. I was the first time I'd ever been in Ireland, in Dublin, 86. And we're in the, I can't remember, it's no longer there now, but it was where the Wolftones used to play every Tuesday night. I think the game was on a Wednesday. And they were playing in this, and it was, I always remember it was a place where it was a waitress service for drink. There was no bar, and you just put your order in. And the Celtic board came in that night, and everybody was clapping them and that, you know, because, oh, it's a Celtic board and that. And then, I remember, they went up, and they had a wee confab with the Wolftones. And then the next thing, fucking Brian Warfield, like, this one's been requested by the Celtic board, and it was armoured cars and tanks and guns. Change days.
Oh man, I know. Is it the big Steen used to play the Rebels in the bus, did you know?
Billy McNeil, I mean, my mate told me there was a Celtic pre-season tournament in Rimini, and it was like 80, I think it was after we'd won the double in 88, and Billy McNeil had the Zane Ghetto Blaster, and it was all Rebs they had on it, and Jack McGinn was kind of saying, oh, you think this will be all right, Billy? And he said, oh, get them on, and that was it, kind of thing. Because there was only about 200 fans that went there, like, you know, yeah. And he had big ghetto, you know, the big old school Ghetto Blasters, you know, like Radio Raheem, and he had the tapes on, the Boys Old Brigade and everything, like, you know.
I know, there you go. Change days indeed. Change for the better, what do you reckon?
I mean, it's ebbs and flows. I mean, look, it's for me, everybody here's, you know, been to places like Belfast and all that kind of thing. It's like you go over there and it's like, you know what? I was just reminded why I sing Rebel songs in the first place. You know what I mean? When you see the murals and you meet the people and that. So to me, it's been part of fan culture forever. And if anybody wants to change that, they need to have an adult debate about it. It's certainly not to just go and try and change the culture, because you'll never do that.
I know. It's the young ones want to sing it. You know, I think they've had their day. You know, it's not for me any longer. But I totally sung them all when I was younger. But you can see for the young ones' point of view, how can we not sing them and use that? You know, so it's kind of like that. But unfortunately, with that draconian law that's in there now, you need to just watch yourself and stuff like that. So what's our plans? Em, to get any plans for the summer?
I'm going to Ireland for a week with my two boys, first week in July, just a wee break. Apart from that, that's basically it, really.
What is heading off to in Ireland, Paul?
Limerick, Dublin and Cork.
There you go. But Joe, are you going to Vegas?
Yes, next year. In Vegas next year.
Next year, mate, what's your summer? What's your summer this year?
I think we're going to Crete. She's going to Crete.
Crete, aye.
You see big Samaras over there? No,
Samaras
will be in the World Cup, won't he?
Samaras will be the president of Crete.
That in here, did you see all those jokes going around about the girl that won the fellow that the winner won the Eurovision? And all the Samaras jokes, that was hilarious.
Sammy won the Eurovision. That was Toker looking at that. I actually turned that on, that bloody Eurovision Song Contest. Oh man, what a shambles.
It was a great song, though. Great singer, like.
Aye, brilliant.
What are you doing your summer? You're on holiday all the time.
Me?
Aye. You're a more Hallies.
Several of these are Alan Wicker.
I was going to say Judith Chalmers.
2 weeks in Spain. Going to a Torremolinas for a week, and then we've got a hire in the same valley we went to last year.
Is McVeigh going with you?
Ireland. Aye, going with him.
Happy days.
Yeah, okay. So maybe try and get a wee trip to Seville or gonna.
You're also going to Belfast. You're also going to Belfast soon.
Aye, I'll be meeting you over there, Joe.
Can't wait, looking forward to it.
Aye, really. 2 weeks.
But you'll probably be on good behaviour as soon as you go home early the next day.
Certainly. Oh, well, I'll probably have a few pints of the black stuff, you know.
How did the communion go the weekend? Everything go well?
Communion, aye, it was my wee boy's first Holy Communion on Saturday. I went swimmingly. Went excellent, and I just had everybody back here after it, and I had an absolutely great day. I'll tell you a wee story. My mum, she was howling at the church. The priest was asking the kids, so what gift are you getting the day? And some of them were just like, for communion. He's like, I'm looking for a bit more, And Rory's in there. I don't want to shout and embarrass him. But the priest went, Rory, can you tell me what we're getting today? And he obviously gave the answer. I was at the other end of the church. I couldn't hear it. And the priest says, I want you to stand up and shout that and tell everybody. And he says, it's the greatest gift in the world. The old priest was loving it. He's like, even at Mass yesterday, he's like, there was a young lad, he gave me the best answer I've ever heard in my life.
He's got that Higgins
patter
then, has he?
So when he was up getting his first communion, me and Linda standing behind him, and the priest's like, I think you've either got an RE teacher or a priest teacher.
You standing there going, aye, that's right, that's right.
Aye, old Father Higgins.
Pope Higgins.
No, that was good. So, no, the rain stayed off with a great wee day, kids to the bouncy castle and stuff like that. And tidying this house up yesterday was no fun, I'll tell you that.
Ooh, can imagine that.
I have a great day, happy days. I didn't even see much of the football either, see, because that was on. I was sort of watching wee bits of it. We all count St Johnson deserved to win. Paul, you were at the game, eh?
Aye, it was St Johnstone fully deserved that. I was really impressed by them. They solid in defence, their midfield ran themselves into the ground, and May was excellent, and so's the boy Stephen McLean as well. I think he doesn't get a lot of kind of newspaper headlines like Stevie May does, but he does a hell of a lot of graft for Stevie May. And not thoroughly deserved. And you know, I thought obviously I was there supporting Jackie and Sid, but I thought Jackie was really magnanimous after the game. I mean, it was fine margins. I mean, Dundee United hit the woodwork twice and chances and all that kind of thing, and it just wasn't their day. And I think they acknowledged that. And you know, as Celtic supporters, obviously we wanted to be there. I'd love to be there to watch Celtic win a cup at Celtic Park. But at the end of the day, this is what happens when the playing field gets levelled and other people get a chance. You know.
I know.
Yeah, that's true. See that one, I kind of resent myself to St Johnstone winning whenever Dundee United hit the crossbar, bounced down, hit the keeper, and then just stayed there.
Aye, I was behind that goal, Joe, and I looked at it and I thought, I just thought it was in there. I said, how the hell could I couldn't even possibly, and I said to my son then, I says, that's where you just know it's not your day.
Because I watched the replay, the slow motion replay, and you can see Manus, he actually looks in the goal first, because even he thinks it's in, and you just see him realise the ball next to him, and he just grabs it. You know, but yeah, that was just one of those ones you're like, it's not going to happen here, is it? So we really haven't done much of a look at the season at all tonight, in fairness. Like, we've just been kind of rambling on. The one thing that I should have bet on every year until this year was every year I've been saying, this is the year Chris Commons becomes a star, gets a player of the year, right? And for year on year. And this year it was great to just watch him because he was fantastic. I mean, it really was fantastic.
He was brilliant. He's my player of the year anyway, definitely. So what's everybody's views? Who's going to still be here and who's going to leave in the summer? What would you think, Paul?
Well, I'm hoping Joe McKenna goes, Jason, because I think we've had... Oh, you mean the
team?
I think Samaras, obviously. I think Boruktov, if we can get rid of him. And similarly with Baldy. Apart from that, I mean, I don't think there's any... I mean, the one thing I would say, the one sort of wild card, I think if we were not to get into the Champions League, I think Foster will be touted to the highest bidder in the Premiership. But I'd like to see Big Man stay because I think we've got a really solid defence, great goalie, midfield's evolving, and I think if we add one guy in there and one guy up front, we're going to look pretty good for the Champions League again, I'd say.
I'd love to see Big Virgil and Fraser staying, but I think one of them, maybe two of them, but I think one of them will potentially go. But you're probably right, Paul. The Champions League's a great carrot, and if we can get qualification sorted for that, then if Virgil he's going to get like a kind of Norwich of that coming in for him, then maybe he says to himself, he's still young, I'll have another crack at his Champions League, and then maybe the following year.
I know, but as well, but I mean, Jason, you're also saying, Nick, there, that, I mean, if we don't get the Champions League, Forster's going to get the better off. See if Forster gets a chance in the World Cup and does well. Fucking, we may not be able to keep him after that, you know?
Aye, that's a fair point. So whether he'll get a chance, but because when do you ever see a number two goalkeeper?
I'm just saying, the possibility is definitely there. Yeah. Is that what you mean?
He'd be number one for me. I would play him, but I think he's a better keeper than Joe Hart, but I don't know, but yeah, fingers crossed to him. So how many players have we got in our squad? We've got Izaguirre, we've got Forster. Has anybody else gone to the World Cup?
Samaras, you include him?
Samaras. I think there's five in total, was there? Ambrose, Samaras. Was there one more?
Rodgick. Rodgick.
Tom Rodgick.
Oh, that's Pat Close. Sorry, Pat. Pat Close from half the world away is here.
Great, boys.
How you doing, Pat?
Not too bad. It's a nice early morning over here, and I thought I'd get up early and make a quick call. So I know you're talking about the sort of league and the sort of the past season and stuff, but I just want to go in and off pretty quickly. It's more just to raise awareness for a couple of people, if that's all right, just for 2 minutes. It's just there's a thing going on down in Australia. It's not quite sort of convention kind of level, but we've got a bit of a gathering. Start of next month on June 6th to 8th up in the Gold Coast in Australia. So it's basically Celtic supporters from all over Australia all coming together to, well, I guess not really a convention, it's like really a get together. It's a piss up, let's face it. There's no other way to explain it. There's a piece of piss up. So it's arranged by a guy, Harper knows, a guy called Chris McMonigal. So I'm kind of one of these little foot soldiers, and Chris woke up earlier.
Chris used to call in now.
Yeah, so I used to. I've been sort of helping Chris out a little bit, and he won't get up early in the morning to do it. So he said, I've got the voice for radio, so I have to call in. So actually, I'm not, you might have said, I've got the face for radio, one of the two anyway, I can't remember. But he said to call in. So just to give guys a bit of awareness, because probably our biggest fear is that we've tried to get the word out there through supporters clubs and stuff, but what we're kind of fearful of is that and it kind of happens over, you meet a Celtic fan in the street, you know, you're wearing the hoops, and some guy starts chanting to you, and we're just a bit fearful that you're going to meet somebody in a month's time, and they're going to go, oh, how's it going? Oh, are we at the Gold Coast? And they're not going to know about it, if you know what I mean. So,
yeah.
And I guess just the spread that you guys have, you know, and the people that listen to it, I thought we'd make I know it's last day of the season, but just a 5 minute call, let people know that it's happening. So,
repeat the details, Pat.
So basically, I could give you the website, but Chris is actually in the process of moving it between providers. So it's there, it's just down at the moment.
All right.
So basically, if you go into Facebook at the moment, the easiest way is through Facebook, and it's if you search for Gold Coast Celtic, it's basically just a Facebook group. There's about 170 or so on it. We've got around 100, 120 going at the moment. So there's a lot of guys in Brits. So Gold Coast isn't far from Brisbane. So there's a lot of the guys in Brisbane, not the Brisbane CSC, haven't kind of booked up yet. So the numbers are probably going to increase. There's quite a few guys in Sydney. They're only not even an hour flight from the Gold Coast. So there's still a lot of cheap flights around there to get to the Gold Coast, even from Melbourne. I checked last night. It's like a $200 return. But Chris has done a brilliant job. He's arranged pretty much everything. I mean, there's guys like myself, Jim Kinlan, and Stevie Harvey, and we're sort of just trying to do little bits round about for him. We'll try to do like merchandise, for example, some polo shirts and that sort of thing, just to try and raise a bit of money for charity. So, but essentially it starts on the Friday morning, Friday the 6th of June. And that's, there's a golf day, a golf morning, I should say, on the Friday morning. Then on the Friday night, there's a sort of, it's basically just a kind of like a meet and greet for everybody. That's piss up number one. On the Saturday, there's like a football game, sort of, so they're kind of, I guess it's like a select. We called the actual event's called the Huddle Down Under. I don't even know if you can search that in Google, but we gave it a little tag and got a logo made and all that sort of stuff. So it's called the Huddle Down Under. And then we play on a Saturday against a team from Gold Coast, so the team that Chris is involved with, who just happened to play in Inter Milan strips. So there's going to be I guess a reenactment of the 1967 from the Gold Coast. So we've got a good, decent squad. There's a few good players, actually. I was getting told the other day by Chris that there's a few sort of Victorian Premier League guys, and that's a relatively high standard. You're probably talking kind of junior sort of level back home, I guess. They're playing, that's a Saturday afternoon, and then I think some guys are going to wait to play an all round of golf. And this is like a soccer club called, I think it's Merrimack, don't quote me on that, I think it's Merrimack in Gold Coast. And then Saturday night, it's a big bash. There's a band up there called Black Stove. And the main sort of singer guy there is actually the son of Andy Lynch. So they're going to give us a few tunes on the Saturday night, so that's going to be a big event. And then the Sunday, it's Piss Up Number 2. There's a boat cruise on the sort of early afternoon. Sort of obviously just 70 or 80 people on a flipping boat out in the bays and stuff like that of the Gold Coast, or in the canals, actually. But and then on the Sunday night, there's another gathering. There's the chap from the Brisbane CSC, whose name starts with mine, Mullaney, Johnny Mullaney, I think it is, up in the Brisbane CSC. He's going to pretty much do like a set, like a DJ setting up for us on the Sunday night. So Monday, most people will be heading off back home with a bit of a sore head. But it's a pretty big event for us over here. So I just thought I'd phone in and try and spook it a little bit. So
the Facebook page is what there, Pat?
If you search for Gold Coast, just Gold Coast, separate words, Gold Coast Celtic. That's what I normally tell people to do, and it sort of comes up. I think Chris might have closed the group. I don't know what that means in Facebook, if anyone knows. And
Gold Coast Celtic's basketball team as well, apparently.
Well, there you go. Didn't know that. So Gold Coast on the Queensland, the weather will be nice. It'll be, I guess, low 20s up there. So there's guys coming from Western Australia. I don't know how aware you are of the geography of Australia, but it's not just a
5 minutes flight or something.
Well, I reckon I calculated the other day that some of them will be travelling 9 hours to get there. So between getting to the airport, flying over, like some are flying from Perth to Sydney, then they have to wait like an hour, hour and a half, get a flight from Sydney up to the Gold Coast. So some are flying straight into Brisbane and basically making their way from there. It's some of the people get there is just amazing, really impressive. So lucky Melbourne, we're only about an hour and a half away on a flight. It's just it's a real good effort. The guys in Western Australia especially, there's probably a dozen or so coming from over there.
Excellent.
The Mandurah CSC and the Perth CSC. So my mate Kev, who's on does a half a world way thing with us, he's coming over. A couple of mates from his CSC over there. So bloody good effort. So
good stuff. I hope it goes well.
Yeah, so Gold Coast Celtic, anybody's interested in coming, because it's more just to try and let people know if they've got relatives in Australia and stuff, because we're still finding people who don't know about it. You know what I mean? Right. It's just a through conversation. So if anyone has got any relatives, it doesn't have to be Australia, let's face it, it could be New Zealand. Anywhere in the sort of the region, you can still get cheap flights at the moment. Also, Chris has already arranged like the hotel. He's got special rates even at the hotel we're staying at as well. So he's done a really good effort. So we're just trying to, I guess, support that as well. We'll try and support one of the two local charities up there, and we'll raise a bit of money. We'll get some things made up. We'll try to get in touch with Celtic. Give us a few donations, but it didn't quite work out. It seems to be the way these days, isn't it? So
it's a surprise.
Yeah, Joe Mackin, you still on here?
I'm still on, aye.
Do you know fancy it?
Absolutely. I like the way you thought he was going to have, or he's planning to have a break in between his boozing sessions. The guys are on to Sydney with no chance. He'll be drunk from the Friday morning to the Sunday.
A break, yeah. Scheduling a drink break.
Well, there's people in training at the moment. I'm not a big drinker, far from it. But even I tried it, and I kind of keep up with these guys.
I've seen them in Vegas.
It's been no rounds for me. I'll be on morning. Say again, sorry?
I've seen them in Vegas going for a week.
Sunday Paul, I know Brian McAvoy. He's
Brian Paul, even Marianne.
Marianne, I think Marianne's going, actually, but I'm not really sure about that. She was talking about going to Vegas, I think, shortly after. And I think there's someone we're talking about going to one or the other, not both of them. So But no, it's all good fun. I mean, you know, we tried even at one stage, we spoke about trying to invite Paul, but to try and do some sort of, you know, like an asterisk years kind of thing, but we don't have any money, if you know what I mean. The money that's coming in straight back out in the band and the venues and all that sort of stuff. So even things like the polo shirts and that sort of stuff, we're going to have to pay for ourselves and try and recoup that money up there. So yeah, so we'll just try to make a bit of an effort. Well, not me, Chris probably more than anybody. So fair dues to the guy. Hopefully he's listening, and but he'll listen back later.
Pat, I've had a message here from Kralski. I said, ask Pat about the new Celtic team over there.
Oh, yeah. So this is over in Western Australia. This is through, become sort of friendly with Kev. It's Celtic Australis. There are quite a lot of Celtic teams over here already. Like there's St Kilda Celts in Melbourne. There is another Celtic team in Perth whose name slips to mind. It might just be Perth Celtic or something. But there's a new team over in Western Australia called Celtic Australis. And I think you can get them on Twitter. I think it's Oz Celts, OzCelts. So people can sort of look out for them, but they do the same thing. They're trying to raise money for charity and that over there. And
well, they've actually contacted the Gaelic Foundation, so they have.
Is that right? Yeah.
They're hoping to raise, I think it's, they say 25% of what they raised are going to charity, and they're hoping to send 15% over to the Gaelic Foundation.
Yeah, that's right. They've had the ground running over there. I think they're actually doing pretty well as a team as well. So lots of Celtic fans in it. So it's good. No, it's you'd be amazed how much the Celtic thing is over here. It takes you by surprise sometimes. Other side of the world, and I mean, you walk around the corner, there's a guy standing with a Celtic top on. It's just bizarre. And the Celtic number plates and the cars, and it's amazing. So in fact, even I may do this in a podcast actually. I was down a few weeks ago. There's a little place called Port Fairy, way down in the southwest of Victoria, and I've got a mate who lives down there, so just sort of, you know, hanging out there for the weekend. But there's a festival, there's a place called Koroit. It's a Koroit, it's Koroit it's spelled, and they've got a bloody Irish festival, and it's like they close off the main street and there's flipping Irish bands, and you know, the parade. I get wrapped into the parade because some guy had my family originally from Antrim, so I could poke tiny carry in the Antrim flag because nobody else wanted it. So I in the middle of the main street. So the amount of Kerry flags and Dublin flags was just bizarre. But yeah, one Antrim flag and it was me. So
Good man, Pat.
I thought it was going to be really tame. I'll be honest with you, I thought it was going to be so tame. But, you know, so we parked the car and, you know, me and the wife and the kids walked around the corner. And it's just all these little bands, people, you know, the tin whistles and all that sort of stuff and flutes and whatever. You know, just playing outside shops and whatever. And there's about 10 outside the shot, and I just expect to be so tame. Walk around the corner, this little band playing Sean South of Gary Owen. I thought, this is the spirit.
No, the best thing about this, is, I'm sure all that happened while the sun was shining.
Well, yeah.
Same shit happens in Ireland, but it's pissing rain. You know what I mean?
Oh, honestly, it's getting wintertime over here. They were lucky because it was that morning, it was absolutely. Yeah, it's right on the coast, so when it rains, it bloody rains, so. No, but it was good. It was just a really good laugh. I'm going to try and make an effort to go down next year again as well. So, even at the local football team there, the Croyde Saints. So my football Aussie Rules team, St Kilda Saints, over here. So they play in red, white and black. And this is what they play in. But on their badge, on their crest, it's Croyde Saints with a four-leaf clover in the middle of it. Wow. It's just, you know, how far away this place is. You'd be amazed. There's a whole Irish community. There's all the towns. Not all the towns, but a lot of them down. There's Killarney, in fact, Port Fairy used to be called Belfast.
I've told people like the world over, so like no matter where you go, you'll find a Celtic top, right? Now, a friend of mine, a guy I used to work with in a factory back in Belfast back in the 90s. His name's Mick McGarrigle, smashing guy, and he wound up getting made redundant, right? So this is a bit of a long story, but I'll get to the point. But he wound up getting made redundant. He took his money and he said he was going to go around the world for 180 days to use his redundancy money. So he sold his house, got a backpack, went around the world, and the BBC gave him a camera and he documented it, right? He was heading to fucking the Antarctic, right? And he found a pub at the docks in Peru, an Irish pub, and had a Celtic jersey in it. He was on his way to the Antarctic, and it was a Celtic jersey. It was the last thing he saw before he left to head into the fucking icy wilderness. Like, this is everywhere. Celtic caps and Celtic fans are just everywhere.
Can they beat it?
It's brilliant. You drive around Melbourne and you see, you know, look, we all kind of know each other, I guess. There's like those boys, BHOIS, number plates and that sort of stuff. So even driving, like Melbourne's a massive place, but yeah, all those little things just, you know, they just cheer you up, you know what I mean? You just, they kind of mean, they make the world day, you know. It might be just one little thing you see a day. You see a Celts 10 number plate or something, and that's it. You're happy for the rest of the day. So.
Speaking of that, I have to tell you this story, right? Because I have to give this guy a shout out. I was in Ibiza there, last week I was in Ibiza. I was just hanging out in the apartment. I was having a bit of a snooze, you know, just being lazy after eating too much food and drinking too much San Miguel. And my wife appeared on the balcony, and she goes, because we're on the ground floor next to the pool, she's like, oh, there's this guy here, I want to talk to you. And it was a guy she just started talking to at the pool, and he's wearing a Celtic jersey. And he says to her, oh, do you like football? And she's like, no, my husband likes football, you know. You probably know, I'm just joking, like, because she thinks all Celtic fans know each other. Says it's Joe. And he says, Joe? She says, he does like a radio show or something. And he goes, like, oh, from the Homeboys. So she brought him over to the apartment to meet me. And as the apartment got like standing there, like more or less with jacks, just going, what's happening, man? But make sure to Colin and his wife, Claire, and the wee girl, Kira, because we ended up having a few drinks on my last night there with Colin and Claire and Kira. So I think that showed it. But that sort of stuff's really cool. I mean, plus the best thing was, there was a couple of Ayrshire Huns in the hotel, right? And they were watching Formula One while we were watching Dundee United in Celtic. And so we made plenty of extra noise on their behalf because they were sitting there looking at us.
There's a couple of companies down here. They've got Celtic Builders, and they've got the Celtic crest on the front of the trucks and stuff. Amazing. And I'll tell you the best one actually. There's a guy down here. I won't name names, but he owns his own company here, and it's like security doors and stuff. And I think the company obviously colour is green, but he's named the company Celtic. So instead of Celtic, it's Celtic. Oh, so I thought it was really clever. So anyway, that's his subtle way of spreading the word.
Well, we're
Sorry, Pat. I'm head off, guys. I need to get ready for work. So, spend that a few minutes. Just anybody who's interested, you know, try and get in touch. Chris, we've all kind of access to the Facebook thing. The website is down at the moment. You can take a note of it if you like, because it will be up in the next sort of day or two. He's just changing providers. So, that's just GC Celtic. GCCeltic.com.
Tweet it to the Homeboys tweet, and then we'll retweet it for you.
Just if people go there now, it'll just say...
GC Celtic, what? I just read it down here. GCCeltic.com.
So www.gcceltic, as in Gold Coast Celtic. GCCeltic.com. I mean, we put the events on. There's not really a big expense. Like the Saturday night you pay for, and the boat cruise, I think there's about 70, 80 people going on that. It sold out in like 2 days, 3 days. There was that much interest in it. That was about 6 months ago. So Chris has got tickets and that made up. He's mailed them out to everyone. And it's just, it's a really good event. Big for us. I said, don't get me wrong, it's not the same scale as what you guys would experience at Vegas. But, you know, it's a starting place for us, you know what I mean? In this little backwater called Australia.
That's brilliant, though. Because, I mean, like, that's what we've always said in this show. Like, the best, I've always said to my wife, and the best thing about Celtic fans is all they want to do is get together. I mean, and just have a good time, you know, and talk about Celtic and support Celtic and celebrate Celtic. That's one of the main reasons, like, for big. Like, that's anytime I've been abroad or lived abroad or gone abroad, Celtic's always been a companion to me. So that's what I love about, you know, hearing things like this. You know, you couldn't be further away from Celtic Park, like, you know what I mean. But still, like, you know, the fire is there to get together and celebrate Celtic, and I love that. I love it.
Yeah, it's tough sometimes. It really is hard being a Celtic fan down here. You know, the 2 o'clock in the morning. Wake up calls to watch a game and stuff, but there's so many of us still do it.
It's part of the experience, yeah. I suppose, isn't it?
It is. Oh, it's knackering, though. You've got two young kids, it's flipping tiring. You go to bed after watching a game at 2 a.m, you're up again 2.5-3 hours later. So, it's a hard life sometimes. quickly before I go, just good luck to Paul and all the stuff he's doing. I think it's absolutely magnificent. I listen to the Beyond the Waves podcast. Spectacular.
Thanks.
It'll be an interesting view. So if you decide to have it, any sort of host ending down in Australia, then hopefully the contacts we'll make up on the Gold Coast, maybe we'll do some right across the country, you know what I mean? So obviously Perth guys going, Sydney, Brisbane, guys in Adelaide, lots of guys in Melbourne heading up. So if Paul wants to spread the word, he's probably got a whole family of guys there he can call upon. So.
There's plenty in the pipeline, Tyler. Pat, listen, thanks for calling in, mate.
No worries. Thanks, guys. Thanks for your time.
Hey, Pat.
Off to your work.
Have a good one. See you. Anyway, listen, can I bring your attention as well? First to the 3rd of August, there's an anti-racism World Cup in Belfast. This is the 8th year the Anti-Racism World Cup's been hosted by the West Belfast community of Leonard Doon, and the 7th year at Donegal Celtic FC. The tournament's for a 7-a-side soccer teams from across Ireland to play international visiting teams from Europe and beyond. And the ethos of the tournament and associated events are anti-fascist, anti-racist and anti-imperialist. And the Wakes will be playing on the 2nd of August. So if anybody's about Belfast, get yourself over to Donegal Celtic and support that worthwhile tournament.
You were in Leonard Doon.
I know.
You were at the Hunting Lodge at 10, wasn't it?
Aye.
That's right, aye.
So were you.
I know. I just don't remember. I've been in Leonard Doon. So we've done a piss poor job of running over the season anyway. Put it that way. Anybody else want to mention anything in the next 3 minutes before we wrap up?
Can I say something before I go, lads?
Go ahead, Joe.
One of your listeners, the guy's name is Brian B, I think it was, 67. He actually donated a Tony Watt framed picture of me as he go against Barcelona. I've not had a chance to auction it yet, but just to let him know that we've still got him, I've not forgotten about it, I've just not had time to arrange anything yet.
Aye, perfect. I remember Brian, he contacted me. That was excellent of him doing that.
It was absolutely
fine.
One of 100, I think it is.
Aye, that's right. Aye, limited edition. Aye.
I don't know if we could maybe get it on the show and get one of your listeners to win it. I don't know if that would be an idea.
We can do that next season. So the start of the season, we'll do that, Joe.
Didn't we do like a regular sort of so many tickets, 10 or a ticket type thing, didn't we, before?
Just the fact is, one of your listeners that donated it, so one of your listeners can have a chance of winning it, you know?
Aye, that'd be good, Joe. Aye, we'll definitely do that for you, mate, and then just pass all the money across. Aye, no worries.
No problem.
Harper's your man for that stuff.
we'll definitely
get it done.
Basically, just a last thanks to yourselves. And echo Pat's words there. Paul, keep up the good work. I listened to our podcast this morning, I think it was. It's got some fantastic effort.
I've still got it. Thanks, Joe. I definitely
listen to it. The one thing, right, that I love about those podcasts, Paul, that you and Graham do, is like, because one, you get to really articulate, you know, where it is you're coming from and what it is you're hoping to achieve, right? And plus, you also get to impart the fact that you've been through an awful lot of shit to get here. Right, you know what I mean, and I like the fact that throughout all that, you're at the end of it, you're still like, you know, I want to offer opportunities to other people. You know what I mean? Because we've seen a lot of writers, put it this way, a lot of guys who write about what you're writing about become very much caught up in themselves, right? And you don't seem to do that. If you get where I'm coming from, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think the opportunity thing is important to me in the sense that, you know, I know everybody's like, oh, we were cheated and that's it, blah, blah, blah. But this was a much bigger story than just us being cheated, and that was about denying people like us opportunities. And it just dawned on me about January, February that, you know, whilst we are talking about being denied opportunities, if we're in the position to then give opportunities, we should do that. You know, we'd like, say, yourself and Claire Fowler, who sung the song, and with other people, and people that are doing animation, is that, you know, taking chances on people and all that kind of thing within the Celtic community was something that I was, you know, really keen to do, because I think you can get caught up in being, you know, because you do get, you know, I get a lot of abuse and threats and that, but I also get a hell of a lot of praise as well. And so I think the real thing is to appreciate it, but not take it either too seriously, you know what I mean? So that you can kind of try and hopefully keep your feet on the ground. And this is a film that's by the fans and it's for the fans. And so, you know, that's kind of the angle that we always wanted to go. And it's on the interviews, you kind of get the chance to articulate what exactly you're thinking about things, and kind of just try and involve the process, was what I've tried to do throughout the film, is to involve as many people as possible in the process, you know, through Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and all that kind of thing, and just hopefully they can feel part of it. And I think that what's happened is it's kind of awakened a lot of people, whereas suddenly obstacles that were there that were huge can be jumped over because people jumped out and kind of helped you. And I've always thought that that's, you know, anybody who tries to claim that they are the only person responsible for one thing is just talking absolute rubbish.
Yeah.
They were always helped by people, and, you know, sometimes people didn't even realise they've helped you. Yeah. And this has allowed me to give the opportunity to see people, no, actually, we want you to do this because of this or because of that or because of talent and things like that. And so, you know, I think that's kind of important that we sort of do that and try and involve and enrich as many people as possible, you know?
Yeah. I was telling you that, I listened to it today, it was brilliant. I was cleaning the house, doing bits and pieces because of the day off, and I really enjoyed it, really, really enjoyed it. Very good. So, listen to it, folks. It's well worth listening to. I have to go to bed. I'm tired. I'm working in the morning. This season was good. I enjoyed it. I enjoyed watching the trophy being raised. Can't complain, you know. And yeah. I actually think, I just thought today when I was just kind of listening to the podcast, I was like, I think the longer we are without Rangers, right? I think we live in a world right now where things are forgotten so quickly that the idea of Rangers in the, if they're not in the top league by the next 2 to 3 years, it won't matter ever again. You know?
Good point.
Well, I hope that's true. I hope they never ever play it again.
I just don't think it'll matter.
They might, in whatever form they're existing in now, they might not even be there next year. Mm. There's no accounts, it's just they're killing themselves here within.
What is it, 4,000 season tickets they've had people claim to, they want? 4,000 season tickets, that's it.
I mean, the thing is, Fergus McCann came in and took over Celtic, but even though he had no time for the old board, they still paid them off. So why does this knight in shining armour for South Africa, why does he not come in and just pay whoever it is off?
Because he's not got the money.
There you go.
Simple as that.
It's like that part of the generation game where everybody go, a cuddly toy.
I had two conversations with two prominent journalists back in December, and I told both of them, one's very much Sevco leaning, and the other one is very much Celtic leaning, but both are peddling this Dave King's the saviour line. And I said, I'll tell you right now, that man does not have the money to do what you're saying. And they both of them said, and to be fair, the Celtic leaning one, I said to me, actually, I'm starting to believe what you said. That's the reason he stayed out in jail in South Africa. He paid his way out. And he does not have the money. It's as simple as that. Because at the end of the day, you're dealing with people at that club right now who are effectively spivs. And we all know what they like more than anything, money. And if he had, as Jason just said there, how did Fergus get rid of the old board, really? He paid them. And that's the same scenario here. But there's nobody willing to step forward. And that's why you've got Chris Graham and all the rest of the Bampots trying to starve that board out so that they can liquidate again and King picks the whole thing up for next dinner.
That's unreal. You know, just dignity, brother. just before we go as well, just say a big hail hail to all the other shows on the Hail Hail Media Network and to all the guys who write the blogs on the Hail Hail Media Network. Just big thanks to all them as well, because it's not just about Homeboys here, there's loads of other shows. And they all do a great job, and I think it just makes the network what it is. So just a big thanks to everybody for writing your blogs and doing the shows. And here's the next season.
Absolutely. Listen, there'll be content during the summer, not as regular as this, but we have a few things, hopefully trying to line them up. See if you know anybody famous, like really famous to support Celtic, just email us, because we'd love to talk to them. Just put that out there.
But email them first.
I email them first and clear it to them. I mean, just but you know, tell them about us. I mean, anyway, listen, we're out of here. Going to finish off. There you go. That's it. Another season down, and we of course closed it like a badly carpentered door. So listen, that's us for the rest of the year. We'll be back and forth, let's say, in the summer. Things happening. I'm sure there'll be more Asterisk Years news, hopefully at some point. And folks, that's it. Hail, hail.
Here's the treble.
That's it. Next year's main four in a row coming up soon. All right. Take it easy, folks, lads. Thanks very much.
Hail, hail.
Hail, hail. Good luck.